Oh, it's the full body dancing this morning.
It is.
Woo! Guess where we are.
How can we be this excited this early in the morning in Vegas?
First,
good morning, gang.
I think we need to do a sound check. Oh, yes, do the Zoom for me. Do the mug Zoom one. There we go. Woo. Hey, can you guys hear us? Is that all good? Volume good?
How's the dancing, folks?
Sarah, can we get a thumbs up? Awesome.
Very good.
And the music sounds good, too? I could leave it up here, but my arm's going to get really tired.
The video is cloudy. Well, yeah. It's Vegas. There's too much smoke in the air.
Everybody,
it's all the gamblers.
Everybody put out your stogies. Hey, let's get this thing started.
Let's do that.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Okay. Good morning, everybody.
Where are we?
I don't know. Are you giving me a hug? I don't know. It's well, Vegas, baby. You just go with it.
That was spontaneous.
Really much better now? My Dutch is okay.
Yes.
Inside joke. Yeah, I don't know. Outside joke? I don't know. Inside voices.
Yes, we all know this.
No kidding.
So, yeah, welcome to the attic, Wednesday morning.
How's everybody doing? I know we're doing okay. We had a good night's rest.
We did, sort of.
In Vegas.
Yeah. We have a crew behind us. Can anybody see people there? What? Who's this? Oh, look, we have people that actually woke up this morning. Everybody give a big shout out. Say, hey, what's happening?
Hey, what's happening?
Woo. These are amazing people. It's Don just cracked over here and inside, and they're here, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. Is that the right phrase? Bright-eyed. Bright-eyed.
We're gonna wander back into the crowd, and the video may be still a little bit cloudy, but you can see we're at DevLearn 2019 in Las Vegas, just outside of the expo. So if you're here, if you're watching from your conference room, we have free coffee. So if you still want to come down and
you got lots,
you know, of course the event has free coffee too, but
ours is better.
You know, feel free to come join us and have a conversation. So we're going to talk microlearning. Sorry, let's get right to the point.
Our coffee has more love.
We also have hugs.
We have hugs too.
For hugs.
Yeah. Come on, let's bring everybody a little closer, only because of I'm worried about microphones.
I think we're fine with
microphones.
Oh, yeah.
We'll see how that goes.
Everybody's kind of like,
I don't want to get in there. They're going to make me dance.
Look, coffee is one thing, but getting on screen.
All right, quick, let's go. Let's go around the horn really fast and say, what do you think microlearning is? Go, Sam.
It's like learning about micro. It's really
fun. Effective learning.
Effective or effective?
Whoa! Dude, that's too much.
Keep it drinking.
That's
too early. Yeah.
Bite size.
Focus.
The right length for the right content.
The right length for the right content.
Very good, very good. We're outside of the camera. There you go.
Hello.
Definition of micro learning.
Compact
learning. All right, good.
Fits in the hatchback.
Jack.
Hey, everybody. You know, there are lots of definitions about micro learning out there, and everybody kind of has their own, which I think is one of the reasons we're going to talk about this today, so that we can get an understanding of what microlearning is. But I think if you take everything everybody said, that would be what I would say microlearning is.
Just show off.
She gets away with that. She's the last in the world.
We're down here for today.
That's instructor-led technique right there. Summary.
Bring it all together.
Awesome. So we've talked about this, I think, a while ago in reference to the article that Patty Shank had done.
Yes.
Where she was focused on, in that article, very much the learning word of microlearning. Because a lot of the people, I think, you also think of microlearning as just stuff you find and to help you in a moment of need. So do we really care that there's maybe this idea that microlearning, if it has learning in the title, that it should be formal and therefore part of a learning thing? Or do we care that that term could also be used then for like things like performance support? How do we care about that word being used in multiple ways?
It's not caring, but I think it's content and context.
Content and context. There we go.
So I think it's what works, and I think that's the biggest thing, is what works. Because we can get so hung up on learning, but it's also, we know that it has to work right before when they need it, and then it kind of joins into this whole big movement of workflow learning. So,
things get kind of blurry, don't they, after a while? And that's a good thing, probably, I would say. Anybody want to disagree with that?
Quick, let's have a fight. Let's argue.
John is on it today.
Nailed it. I think it flows nicely into kind of how a lot of us look at what we do. I've always organized it into the content, context, and people, right? Just if we're going to oversimplify what we do, we focused on people, we're focused on content, and we're focused on context. And microlearning kind of fits right into that groove because of all of the things that we can do now. Can anybody create microlearning, or just because somebody creates content, does that necessarily mean that they're creating learning?
That's the age-old question, isn't it?
and I chose my words carefully because I did not use the words correctly in my own personal definition, just to see if anybody cared. And none of you did, so I feel like
maybe
I have not.
Maybe we're sleeping still.
maybe it's too early. Sam's got an itch. He wants to jump in here. Let's do this.
We all use all our words wrong all the time. Uh-huh. So I try not to let it get to me.
Uh-huh, me too.
But none of us makes learning.
Right.
Learning is made in here on an individual basis. We make assets that hopefully help that happen. But don't ask too many questions because no one really is tracking that very well.
Yeah. So to my point, to my question again then, understanding the difference between training and learning, when somebody creates a piece of content, could it be microlearning? If it's all of those things that you guys said, if it's compact, if it's short, if it's within a context?
I'm trying to think of a reason why not, but I can't. So I would say yes, I guess. But I'm feeling like I'm also walking into a trap.
No, I asked the question because I think about it a lot and wonder how do we get to these better definitions, and that it's a great way to look at the opposite, right? To go after, okay, well, what is it not, in order to figure out kind of what it is. And I've always been a big proponent to Sam's point, learning happens up here. Learning's not our responsibility. Our responsibility is to create environments and experiences or small bits of content that influence the learning. And we hope that the learning is gonna happen, and we hope that it happens more efficiently, but we can't make it happen. I can't learn you.
Oh. I'll learn you good.
I can try.
Let's maybe take a glance at the questions.
Well, there's a good idea.
Probably a ton of comments.
Didn't there are. Surprise, there's some opinions. do you want to...
Which one? You want to scroll up?
I was just going to say, where did the good things start?
I haven't been following. L&D had to have a name for everything, so learning that is every day and does not make... The traditional title is called microlearning.
Well, that's an interesting thought, that microlearning is the thing, is stuff that isn't like part of a regular course in some way. It's a catch-all term for all the things that don't maybe fit a normal definition or a traditional definition of a course. I think that microlearning does have actually a more focused raison d'etre than that, though. It's not just a catch-all. I think it is a tool. Wait, Anna, you
have
an opinion.
Question. So newbie in the field, when I heard the term microlearning, I understood it as a way of putting together material, so like a technique or a schema, I guess. But now I'm hearing it almost in a different light or different definition. So just curious.
And I think that that's a perfect example. It gets used for so many different things. I don't know that there's a specific framework for microlearning in a sense, because people say YouTube videos, that's a microlearning, or a job aid could be microlearning, or could be short courses. But one of the things, let me just stop and have a talk.
Oh, and you can step into frame.
No kidding. I'll come back in, guys. So one of the things we saw with microlearning when the buzzword first rose up was a number of vendors who would take something and then they were now they were selling you microlearning.
Yeah.
But really, I think an argument was that they took something and they chucked it up, and it's the same stuff that they were, you know, that we were willing to sell you as a learning opportunity, you know, ahead.
Yeah.
So it was really, you know, take the word, staple it onto something, and now we can market it differently as an angle, as opposed to creating something brand new in a sense that helps people maybe in a different way that I think microlearning has a lot of possibility for.
Yeah, and so is it different when we make it as an industry of professionals and when somebody else just creates a piece of content and somebody views it and they accidentally learn something from it?
Accidentally.
Right, so is that the same as when we create short, compact, small-ish content that has a purpose? Like, we go at it with a purpose from our industry. Is it different? Is it the same? Is one micro learning and the other not? Are we going to be elitist about it and separate ourselves?
They don't have a purpose when they create that content. You're assuming they don't have. You're saying we have a purpose, so it's different. But I'm saying they probably have a purpose for putting it out.
Exactly.
Why would you make something unless
you were putting it out there? Yeah.
Exactly,
and I guess that's the part where that I struggle with the term. It often feels like just another term, you know, mm-hmm. that we struggle. So it's more of a marketing thing than it is an actual thing that we care about.
I think it's still useful, as long as it's useful. I coming from like the music background, I compare it to like, am I buying the track? Am I buying the album? Who made it? Like, you can find somebody. We could just like plug in something and record something and release it and not like be a musician or a professional or whatever, and people can still like it, they can still get value from it. But if you have someone who is professional about it and it's produced in such a way that it's gonna work better for how it's displayed, for how it is that we're putting it out there, like your little home recording probably isn't radio worthy. It's probably not going to appear in that format really well, but it might still be worth listening to. And, you know, if there's a lot of heart in it and a lot of good purpose behind it, then great. But it's not, it like any music genre or anything, it's just a marketing term. It's not actually describing anything about the value of it. It's just a way to get it out there and help it find like things, help it find an audience.
I like that.
Yeah. We're going to clip that one.
That's good.
Very cool.
That works.
Do we care if something's called microlearning? Do we care about and or how do we track it? Do we care about that?
That's a tough question. It really is.
Jack says that's a tough question. Sorry, we're all kind of wedging off screen here.
Because you've got the people who are going to say, it's really important to track everything that a learner does. So if, oh no, don't do that.
it was off camera for a reason, Sam.
but they'll say something like, we got to track everything. And I don't know whether it's a reporting thing to say, this is the engagement level. Or this is, you know, almost like a defense report to say,
the CYA.
We can defend what we're doing, what we're creating, what people are using, and we can continue to do so because this report says all these people access this piece of content, whether they learned from it or not. So, mm-hmm. I don't know, it's a tough question, Brent.
Well, I think sometimes you can not track that microlearning, but you can track the job performance and what they've learned from it, whether it impacts them.
It's hard to get people who are not us,
yes,
to look at job change in job performance, improvement in job performance, right? They're looking at statistics, not the job performance or how they capture job performance and job performance statistics. So I think so it's a tough one.
Good question, Brent.
He had a good data. It was Chris's question about the data, but Jennifer jumps in into the chat and she says, my main issue for myself with microlearning is that I don't have access to an LMS or to a separate budget to buy into a microlearning LMS package at work at the moment.
We don't put any of our microlearning within our LMS. We really pull a lot of our stuff out of the LMS because we're in operations versus within HR.
Yeah.
So we have our own stand-up SharePoint portal, and we store all of our things on there, including we just created a lot of microlearning for our models. So I don't think you're
So how do you track that, though, to get back to Chris's question?
Right now,
do
we don't.
Okay.
But in the future, we do want to track some of it, not all of it. So we're going to use probably like Microsoft Forms or something like that, and you either do an assessment or you submit that you took it, kind of attest to it, and then we'll be able to track it.
Awesome.
That's kind of crazy because that sounds like you're expecting people to behave like adults, you know, attesting that they took it. I mean... that seems to me like risky territory.
Well, and then we get, you know, we'll get competitive and get directors against each other.
Nice.
So then they'll get on their people and then they'll start doing it.
There we go. Peer pressure.
Yep.
Peer pressure is a motivation.
Yep.
Nice.
Yeah.
Very cool.
For sure.
Can I weigh in on the data thing?
Yeah.
I was just here Monday doing a whole day long workshop about data to drive training decisions. And there's really only one reason to track stuff like at that level, which is to make a decision about what we're going to do in the future. Are we extending this program? Is it going to go to more people? Is it working? And if it's not, are we cutting it? Like with microlearning, with anything, we're not really measuring learning anyway. Like back to the definition part.
Yeah.
If you put a score at the end, that's one data point. You're not measuring learning, which would be like before and after or anything. Maybe you're measuring knowledge. But if you want to track a data point, know why you're tracking it. And what you're saying about, like, we don't really track it. Like, if it's doing the job that and everyone's fine with it, then investing the additional tracking probably isn't really worth it. Like, it's more that performance award model than necessarily the formal, you know, L&D kind of thing. We need to show value. If everyone's fine with the value that's being shown, then great.
Yeah, like, why even go that extra mile? Do they have, one of the things that I've found, and this may be off topic a little bit, but to that point of value and whether or not people want it, I think we've run into it a lot, especially within larger enterprises. We're doing a lot of cool stuff in our industry with XAPI and with being able to collect data and doing some very, very cool things. And I don't think our business leaders know what's possible. Are we doing a good job talking to them about what's now possible that maybe wasn't 5 years ago, even?
I'm trying. I think the hard thing is we have to try to figure it out first to be able to sell it. So some of it, like XAPI, I'm trying to figure it out so I can better sell it instead of start to talk about it and get lost in the connection view.
Well, if we're coming at it from the point where we need to invent it and then go to somebody and tell them to care about this thing they don't even know exists yet, it's probably not going to work out so well. They have stuff that they're tracking if they're in business. There's something that they're looking at. So being able to better align what we do with the metrics they're already using to keep an eye on things is a way more friendly way to go. Like learning to speak their native language. How is it that we talk about results here? How can we show value here? It's different from organization to organization what they're tracking, but the better we can align to that, then the better everyone can see the same thing. It's not like, oh, there's this new thing. Like, how can XAPI support whatever it is that we're already tracking? Or, you know, whether that's NPS or some kind of like score that maybe we don't believe in, but we can support it, then there's nothing to sell.
I think the speaking their language part is huge because I've been talking XAPI and data and all our data is siloed and yada, yada, yada. And last week I came across a senior leadership team, the boss ordered me a slide deck from, you know, their mandates for our department. And one of the things was figure out a way to show that what people are doing on the job is that what you're training to is impacting what's going on the job. I'm like, that's what I've been saying for the past 2 months. He's like, but you didn't say it that way.
Nice.
You're like, dang it, so close. You almost had it. Right? Where are we at? How much time do we have? Oh, we got all sorts of time left.
Or we can make this a micro-learning podcast.
A micro-practice. Looks like we have a newbie. Come on into the circle. Again, you can't just hang out on the outside.
Well, I was trying to get off of frame. I can
see how it happens.
I can see me. So I can be over here somewhere.
There's a few of us doing that.
You need the voice. That's a good one.
Good. It's very welcome. Good.
Thanks for joining us.
I'm sorry, I'm late. The train was closed.
Oh, man.
It's run until 7.
We forgot about that. We forgot about turning it on this morning.
You guys have the button.
Checklist. I needed a job aid.
Turn on the train suggestion.
No micro-learning there. Did you get yourself some coffee?
I did.
Okay.
Cool.
Thank you.
Yeah, we have plenty. So did we have any other questions in the chat? Looks like
I'm having trouble reading from an angle here. So Angela's pointing out business leaders want to see utilization for it. Goes with Sam's idea of metrics, business knows functions, innovation. Wow, I'm having trouble reading this morning. But
we do have a professional voiceover artist.
Oh,
really small.
Yeah. From a distance.
Business knows functions, innovation unites no features. Angela, can you rewrite that for us?
Oh, units. She's added units.
Oh, sorry. Okay, I missed that.
Okay.
Now we're on. You got it?
Well, I'll go back and reread again. Business leaders want to see utilization for it. Goes with Sam's idea of metrics. Innovation units, no features. I'm sorry. We're still messing it up.
Not Angela. Unites units. Yeah,
okay. I'm still messing it up. I'm not able to copy paste from business. Sorry. No worries, Angela. It's on our side. It's us. Trust me.
Seriously, need another cup of coffee.
No kidding.
Really, in Vegas is a lot earlier than anywhere.
Yeah.
Anywhere else.
It's a unique time concept. Very cool.
So fun. And Joe's also echoing what Sam is saying. I think if microlearning can be tied to business function, can we then get it tied to their metrics? With what Sam said. Yes, I didn't even read it all the way through. So yes, she was agreeing. People totally get that. When is microlearning not appropriate?
Someone else go ahead. I heard it, I saw a body motion. But I have thoughts.
I think if it solves the problem, then surely it's anytime. It's that comes back to, is it a viable learning? Does it make sense in the head? Does it become a learning? But it's also, when we talk about data and we talk about thinking, the big thing for me is continuous learning. Because everybody here, we all know Ebbing House, we're getting curve, yada, yada, yada. The fact is, as humans, we have no magic bullet. We can't do one bit of 3-minute e-learning, that is micro-learning or gamified or whatever. That is not the magic bullet to learning. So it's how do we actually create continuous learning so that people can have that experience, learn from it, and also be able to get it at the time when they need it, so that then that comes back to data, and that will prove that they know that element. So yeah, for me, as long as it's a viable learning solution, why not?
Mm-hmm. I was thinking somewhat parallel. There's an urge somewhat, though, to take things and make them small so that they can be consumed, when the actual thing you're trying to teach people is actually kind of big. So separating out the learning process into 27 5-minute nuggets is not productive unless they're going to actually be able to bring that all together and have it make a cohesive experience, especially when things are either very strongly connected or some processes you simply can't break down into separate things anyway. They've got to be part of something bigger. So sometimes 2 hours is required to learn something, etc. So that's where I come from.
As you mentioned 5 minutes. Is 5 minutes micro?
Okay, I didn't.
Oh. Yeah.
Wait, anyway. I
nailed the question.
This is my moment.
That bugs me because I think that it doesn't matter the length of it, but it's more about what the focus and target of it is. So that just really bugs me. And Shannon Tipton, I think, has an excellent kind of analogy for this. She shared about, like, you have a candy dish full of Skittles, and you can keep pulling out, like, these Skittles in different whatever, but
you don't have to eat the whole thing of Skittles right then unless you want to, but being able to, right?
It's
but the fact that, you know, they say 5 minutes, 6 minutes, what if something like super complicated, or what if it's mm-hmm. about like working on machine or something, life or safety? I mean, you don't necessarily want to put somebody's life in danger.
No.
Just because you're trying to cut something off in 5 minutes. So that's a peeve of mine. Just wanted to get that.
Yeah.
Well said, Kara.
Come for the day.
Yeah. I know. Everybody's decided they don't want to be on camera anymore, obviously, as everybody wanders off to the edges.
Yeah. That's true. There's a lot of coffee going on.
Did we have any other questions in there? Everybody on the chat really wants to see, right? Let's get a group video photo. So everybody,
let's put everybody together.
Everybody in the shot. And then Sierra or somebody grab a screenshot of this. If you have not already.
Josh is not a shorty.
No, it's all good. There
we go. This is micro collective.
It's like Night at the Museum.
It's the biggest idiotic ever for micro learning.
Somebody quick do a screen grab. It's on the chat.
Post it on Twitter.
Cheese. Okay, now the goofy face shot.
Oh wait, that was my first shot. Sorry, that's my default. That's my baseline.
Okay, wait, now the happy smile. Awesome. Hey, thanks guys for hanging out with us. Holy smokes, we had no idea people would even want to come and hang out at 6:30 in the morning and have coffee with us. And we really appreciate it.
Absolutely chuffed to have everybody here today.
Hey, fun.
Hey, shall we dance?
We shall dance out of here. Let's, before I forget, and everybody has to get in the shot
for the dance.
Right?
We did it this morning, sorry.
Oh, come on.
Here we go, everybody. Thanks again, everybody, for joining us. Come on, Ed.
No problem. What is he doing with his coffee? We don't know.
It's Vegas, baby.
Welcome to Vegas.
Thanks, everybody. Catch you next time.
Adios, folks.